You're listening to The Hour of the Con. I'm William Cooper. Well, folks, Pooh wanted to come to work with me tonight, and she came along, and about 30 minutes ago, she told me that she wanted to do the Pledge of Allegiance, and between then and now, she has fallen sound asleep. So I don't want her to think that I forgot what she said, and that's why I'm making this announcement, and I also want to let you know that she's probably going to feel bad because she did it. Let me read a fax that I received last night, and I think you'll find it very interesting in relation to the subject matter of last night's broadcast. And by the way, folks, I'm going to tell you right now, if you're listening to The Hour of the Time and you don't have a pen and a pad of paper by your side, you're making a big mistake, because when you call here and say, oh, I didn't get the name of that book, or I didn't have a pen and paper, what we tell you to do is buy the tape. So, giving you fair warning, and I've said this ever since the beginning of this broadcast, we do a lot of work around here. And if 25 of you don't do what you're supposed to do on your end and copy down the information, then that means we have to spend 25 phone calls giving out that information when we could be doing something else. And sometimes it's as many as 50 or 75 phone calls, simply because you didn't have a pen and a pad of paper. So, for those of you who call for that reason, you'll be told to send for the tape. And if it makes you angry, that's tough. We furnish information. We don't babysit. It's your job to write it down when we give it to you. And that's about the way it should be all the time. You got to take your load. And don't call us up and ask us where you can get the book. Go find it. I don't know where you can get the book where you live. You can't have my copy. If you come to this library, you can sit right here and you can read it. You can take notes. You can research all the other books that we have, but you cannot take them out. The facts we received last night. Dear Bill, reprogrammed tonight, the 28th of December, 1994, in big, bold, capital letters, Bravo. You have dragged the rubber mouse past the nose of the cat. Should be a bit of a stampede for reference works this week, assuming those listening understood what you were saying and the import. I have felt like grabbing people by the lapels and shaking some sense into them on this very subject. Most cannot handle it at all. During the 60s, listen closely, folks, during the 60s, while we were engaged in the ferret follies over the Soviet Union, we had a stripped cargo C-118, which is a DC-6, that in spite of just using standard jammable avionics, which is nothing special, made many a trip uneventfully into Soviet territory. The cargo returned was often large crates or boxes. Earlier, upon arrival at the base, it would taxi under power into the hangar and the doors would be closed. As the props rotated to a stop, all personnel would have to evacuate off base and roll call would be taken at the Florida bar. Later, it just parked on the ramp until it took the stuff to the States, refueling back east and probably on to Nevada. You can guess where, I'm sure. Well, if it's up to me to guess, I'd say Area 51. Up front was an honest-to-God booth from a soda shop, Collins KWM1 on the Formica tabletop. In a fridge nearby, a couple of cases of really good beer, always icy cold. Always had one when I worked on the Bird. Bet your beer tasted real good to air crew cooling heels in a primitive strip in Nevada as they awaited unloading. A wooden shack with a candy machine and a Coke machine. Just wouldn't cut it. I was there once at night. Weird. Great work. Ear-to-ear smile on my face for a change. Later, enjoy the mountain, Tom. And I know who Tom is and where he is. I know his last name, but, of course, for his own safety, I will not give that information out over the air. Don't go away, folks. Another really good one. Ladies and gentlemen, all of the original astronauts were Freemasons. Were you aware that in the temple of the Supreme Council of the 33rd degree of the Scottish Rite of Freemasonry in Washington, D.C., as you walk in the door, there's a case full of photographs, one large photograph of a very prominent astronaut standing upon the surface of the moon, holding a Masonic apron in front of his spacesuit, draped over his loins. Mauricio Obregón, in Argonauts to Astronauts. And remember, the secret society, the main one that I wrote about in my book, the one that really calls the shots, is called the Jason Society, from Jason and the Argonauts, the search for the Golden Fleece, the Golden Fleece representing the apron of the Freemasons, the apron of the Pharaohs. The skin that Adam and Eve used to cover their loin when they discovered they were naked. Mauricio Obregón in Argonauts to Astronauts said this: I wonder whether the astronauts do not instinctively adopt a jock style and a wry slang in order to be able to live with such a monstrous enterprise without becoming pompous. Many of them have returned from space quite changed, and some of them have turned to careers in public service, ecology, or religion. Perhaps Earthmen will in time be as affected by the discovery of space as Europeans were by the discovery of America. End quote. And I say, discovery? Are you kidding? Columbus knew exactly where he was going before he even left. And we've discovered the meaning of the flag with the green cross. Or rather, my good friend, Joseph discovered the meaning. For we've all been looking for its meaning, its significance, who it belonged to, why Columbus planted that flag on the beach when he landed on the first landing in America. For he was financed and sponsored by the King and Queen of Spain. By all rights, he should have planted the flag of Spain and claimed that land in their name, but he didn't. He planted a flag with a green cross upon it. And the meaning we have discovered, it is the victory flag of the Knights of the Red Cross of Constantine, which eventually evolved into the Templars, ladies and gentlemen, and exists today. Now, if there were really two space programs, like I have been telling you, And if we were in space long before Apollo 11 landed on the moon, then they knew where they were going also, if indeed they went to the moon. And they may have. See, I'm not telling you that the Apollo series of liftoffs did not go to the moon. What I'm telling you is what we saw sent back and televised on your television sets in your living room was not filmed on the moon. Neither were a lot of the photographs that can be obtained from NASA and can be easily proven by anyone who has the facts about the moon from the scientists approved by NASA and the United States government and the scientific community, and compare those to what we see in those photographs, and it's obvious that those photographs were not taken there. What does all this mean? Well, as always, it means, once again, we've been fooled, suckered, manipulated, lied to. Why? Well, it appears that sometime in the future, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to be confronted with somebody from outer space claiming to be from somewhere else, who may or may not be. And, of course, they don't want us to know that they've been in space for many, many years, because they may have to use an illusion to convince us of this. You see, if they can't find any real extraterrestrials, they may have to use this secret technology, these flying discs they've developed in secret, to convince us that extraterrestrials are real. Or they may have to do it if extraterrestrials are real and just refuse to cooperate with them, because they want a world government. And to have a world government, you have to have an enemy to the entire Earth from outside. And if you don't understand that concept, I refer you to a book entitled The Report from Iron Mountain, The Possibility and Probability of Permanent Peace. You should be able to find it if you look hard. For I don't have any secret sources of information, ladies and gentlemen. I have sources, I have libraries, I have books, I have freedom of information requests. I have a network of people just like you who are digging constantly and sending information into us. So, anyone who looks will find the truth, and the truth will set you free. The new NASA was actually to choose the first astronauts of the Western world when it was formed. Those destined to be among the world's first legally designated envoys of mankind. And the word legally stands out from this text, which means since they emphasized legally, there must have been some illegal astronauts. Anyway, that is the implication. NASA was to carry out a feat that through the millennia had inflamed the imagination of humankind to break the surly bonds of Earth, to quote a popular poem that used to be used to sign off almost every television station across America. NASA thus had a decisive voice in determining just how and by whom those surly bonds would be broken. In some sense, NASA would become the arbiter of Olympus. And, of course, as we now know, the deceptions that NASA has foisted upon the American people and the world, it was absolutely necessary that they choose, and that they choose carefully. For if one of them ever decides to tell the truth, a lot of people are going to be in a lot of trouble. But despite its shiny new title, it was the legatee and recipient of many old traits and trends. First, and perhaps most hopeful, was President Eisenhower's unbending insistence that the space effort have a rigorously civilian character, with a primary emphasis on original research, development, and, of course, exploration. And this, folks, was clearly reflected in the 1958 National Aeronautics and Space Act. If you haven't read it, I suggest you get it and do so. This act was, in fact, the new NASA charter, And it made dissemination of information a duty of the agency. And despite a grant of considerable authority, the purview of the agency was specifically limited to those developments necessary for research and exploration. Yet, even to this day, they refuse to reshare a great majority of all the information and research that they have collected from this so-called space program. If you don't believe me, start digging in NASA for information, and you will quickly find out that there will be walls erected before you. To insulate the program from what Eisenhower feared would be perceptions of involvement with the military-industrial complex, the Space Act and its declaration of policy specified that NASA was to be responsible primarily for research and development associated with aeronautical and space activities, except for those activities peculiar to or primarily associated with defense. It was also required that the administrator of NASA be a civilian. But you know how they got around that, folks? Every administrator of NASA has been a retired or ex-military officer. Every one of them. And most of the hierarchy of the National Aeronautics and Space Administration have also been either retired or ex-military officers. Some of them, in fact, many of them, with MOSs in the intelligence field. In several respects, the United States took a courageous step in July 1958 when President Eisenhower signed the Space Act, which charged the space agency of the U.S. government to lead a strictly civilian, peaceful exploration of space for the benefit of all mankind. And the public believed this to be the only space program of the United States of America. It was, in fact, not true. These, for the benefit of all mankind, were not the words of parochial nationalism and socio-biological territoriality. Three big giant words, actually four, designed to let you know, ladies and gentlemen, that the full intent of all of this is world government, globalism, internationalism, the destruction of national boundaries, the elimination of trade barriers, tariffs, and excise taxes, import taxes, customs requirements eventually will disappear. They were not the words of conquest. They were precisely the words that would turn up almost 10 years later in the unique Outer Space Treaty of 1967, and you need to read that also. For it is affectionately referred to by practitioners of space law as the Mother Treaty. The Mother Treaty. A mother, as you know, has many children, depending upon the mother, but in this case, definitely many children, most of which you know nothing about, some of which you can get your hands on. But in any case, you need to get as many as you can and read them. You will be amazed. The United States Space Act seemed to strike an unorthodox and elevated philosophical and political posture usually witnessed only in extraordinary times. It was this: the nation were at war. Great sacrifice was expected. All eyes were directed toward Houston and Cape Canaveral. NASA's entire legal an organizational environment was formulated to cultivate a broad spectrum of constituencies for its programs, even if those constituencies were comparatively small. NASA, ladies and gentlemen, was deliberately connected to other important constituencies outside the president's office and cabinet. Integrated high-level consideration of space policy and an institutional memory, moreover, were assured by the creation in the Space Act of a broadly based National Aeronautics and Space Council in the executive office of the president, traditionally presided over by the vice president. Still, the old dual military-civilian program remained. Significant early acquisitions of NASA included the Vanguard program of the Navy, the Lunar Probe project of the Air Force, the Jet Propulsion Laboratory of California Institute of Technology, which was actually built into prominence by Jack Parsons, later murdered. Nobody really knows why. At one point, almost everyone who worked at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, including the most prominent scientific minds, belonged to the OTO, the Ordo Templi Orientalis, and the Temple of the Golden Dawn. And the five Army satellite projects at the prestigious Army Ballistic Missile Agency at Huntsville, Alabama. At one point, the chief of psychology at the Army Ballistic Missile Agency at Huntsville, Alabama, wrote me a letter asking me for all available information in my hands on the alien abduction phenomena. For reasons which I will not explain here, I didn't even answer his letter. And believe me, my reasons are good. The continuing nature of this military-industrial-civilian symbiosis, despite the organizational philosophy and extraterritorial nature of the new NASA, was once again apparent in the actions and words of President Eisenhower. Although he insisted in a news conference on 4th November 1959 that non-military space exploration was a, quote, sort of doctrine in America, end quote, he had laid the groundwork in 1958 for the new second version of the dual space program. You see, 6 months before the creation of NASA, in February 1958, the Congress had passed the administration's bill creating the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, nicknamed DARPA, which had its own Director of Space. The next month, pending the formation of NASA, the President gave his approval to the plans advanced by DARPA, making it, in a real sense, the first United States space agency, an agency the public knew nothing about. When NASA was finally formed, the accompanying Space Council was directed to provide a civilian military liaison committee composed of an equal number of representatives from the military departments and NASA, which meant that the military predominated over civilians on the committee 3-1. Also, despite the requirement that the administrator of NASA be a civilian, the Space Act did not require NASA to be managed by civilians in the ranks. NASA was heavily staffed at high levels with retired or borrowed military personnel. In the May 1958 congressional hearings on the Space Act, DARPA Administrator Roy Johnson stated the Eisenhower administration's approved position on the proposed space legislation. His testimony included this statement, and I quote, "The legislation setting up a civilian group should not be so worded that it may be construed to mean that the military uses of space are to be limited by a civilian agency. For example, if Department of Defense decides that it is militarily desirable to program for putting man into space, it should not have to justify this activity to this civilian agency. The NASA Authorization Act should be amended to provide that insofar as such space activities may be peculiar to or primarily associated with weapons systems or military operations, in the case of which activity the Department of Defense will be responsible," end quote. So, it is interesting to note that even the limitation of NASA by its charter purely to peaceful non-military activities was not motivated strictly by altruism. And in later years, we have found that NASA has contracted with the military to put military payloads into orbit and to perform the exact military missions using the space shuttles that its charter forbids. And the public has never questioned this, nor has the charter been changed. You see, all of this delusion and double talk and backbiting and behind-the-scenes maneuvering was as much to keep NASA out of the military's business as it was to keep the military out of NASA's business. The fact that peaceful research and development by NASA also fulfilled non-hostile military needs simply made it easier for the civilian effort in space to be undertaken hand in glove with the military. The Space Act made the intent of the relationship quite clear when it indicated that a primary objective in establishing NASA was to achieve, and I quote, the most effective utilization of the scientific and engineering resources of the United States with close cooperation among all interested agencies in order to avoid unnecessary duplication of effort, facilities, and equipment, end quote. Still, though the intent may not really have been to accomplish a full division of efforts, a striking degree of division remained. It was undeniable that an open civilian program was created ostensibly for the exploration and exploitation of space on an internationally, understand this, an internationally cooperative basis for the benefit of all mankind, with accompanying man-in-space publicity hype and space extravaganzas that convinced most of the United States population, as well as most of the world, that it was the only United States program. There was also a secret commitment to a top-secret space program, the highest priority having been given to space research with a military application, and there was significant military involvement and interest in the new civilian space program, despite the charter forbidding such involvement. And nowhere was the place of the military in NASA programs better illustrated than in the selection of the original astronaut corps. In addition to its general research and development mission, President Eisenhower gave NASA a specific twofold mission in manned spaceflight. The mission was given high national priority, second only to national defense. NASA was, at the earliest feasible time, to launch a man into space, provide him with an environment in which he could perform effectively, and recover him safely. This was Project Mercury. NASA was also to use the support of leading life scientists to develop the capability for extended manned space flight. The original civil service job specifications for Mercury astronauts did not require that an applicant be a pilot. It was felt that the astronaut would simply be a passenger in a cannonball capsule with no controls and no windows. After all, ladies and gentlemen, the whole point was to get the man into space as fast as possible. The government was unwilling to wait for 3 or 4 more years of rocket development so that the Air Force might be able to orbit a real pilot in a real rocket plane, some version of the X-15, for example. Such a feat would be a purely military one, and everyone was mindful of what the Russians were doing. The Russians were launching a virtual menagerie of mice, rats, insects, dogs, guinea pigs, frogs, and mannequins. They were clearly testing the feasibility of manned flight. So, for reasons of international strategic posture and national prestige, NASA was directed to take the quick and dirty approach. It was essential to launch a man in a can on top of a von Braun rocket. Thank you. hour of the time is brought to you, as many of you already know, by Swiss America Trading. Now, I know there are a lot of new listeners out there scratching their heads and wondering, where did this guy come from and what in the world is going on? And you really don't know what's coming down the pike. You're not ready. You're not even ready to listen to this broadcast, to tell you the truth. You have not been prepared for what you're going to hear here, because the truth is a rare commodity these days. And you get huge, almost lethal doses of it on the hour of the time. Well, we wouldn't be able to do this without our sponsor, Swiss America Trading, and we wouldn't have these sponsors if I didn't believe in them and if they didn't offer a product that's going to help you get through the coming years. Precious metal in its various forms. They're one of the very few that guarantee what they do and have a buyback program. They're also the only ones I know that tape every conversation that occurs with them so that they're can be no lies told by anyone at Swiss America Trading, and there can be no lies told by anyone who trades with them. We simply get out the tape and play it back when somebody starts complaining. The truth becomes obvious. Craig Smith and I sit down, determine what it is, and we straighten it out real quick. So you not only have their guarantee, you have mine also. You can't get anything better than that anywhere, ladies and gentlemen. So if I were you, and I cared about my family and my assets, and I cared about surviving the coming years, I would do, as I have done, call Swiss America Trading and put some precious metals under your belt. And by the way, folks, when I deal with them just like you do. No difference at all. Now, make sure that you tell them that you listen to the hour of the time. The hour of the time. Because if you do, if you tell them that William Cooper sent you, you get preferential treatment. Red carpet treatment, in fact. They care about you. They care about the message of this broadcast, and they know that if you're one of the awake ones, then you're going to help save this country. You see, they've lost a lot of business from a lot of people by sponsoring this broadcast. They don't pay me any money. For those of you who just started listening, I get nothing from Swiss America Trading. They pay for the satellite time and the air time. Period. I never touch any of the money. Sometimes, in order to expedite payment, Annie will send a check to the satellite people, and Swiss America Trading will send a check to Annie. When it's not expedient to do that, or when we bill when we're supposed to, and I constantly forget to bill on time, then the checks are sent directly to the satellite people and directly, always, in every case, to WWCR, who are much more patient in their billing. So if you care about this broadcast, and if you care about yourself, number one, you'll call them just to thank them for sponsoring this broadcast. And while you're doing that, you'll ask them how you can put some of your assets into precious metals to protect them against what is sure to come in the very near future. Call now 1-800-289-2646. That's 1-800-289-2646, folks, and do it now. Don't procrastinate. You know how you are. Envoys of mankind, folks, we're not selling it, so don't call and ask how you can get it. You can't get it from us. You're going to have to look for it. It's published by the Smithsonian Institute. The two authors, George F. Robinson and Harold M. White, Jr., are the first men on this earth ever to receive a degree in space law. The book is not fiction. It is written according to the principles of space law. It is a true history of the space program and the involvement of space law. And in the back, there is a treaty called a Convention for Spacekind, which I'm going to read to you now. Article 1. The exploration and use of near and deep space, including all celestial bodies accessible by humankind, shall be carried out for the benefit and in the interest not only of the inhabitants of Earth, who shall be called Earthkind, but of inhabitants of near and deep space as well, who shall be called Spacekind. Such areas of habitation shall be considered the province of Spacekind in the first instance and of Earthkind in the second. There shall be free access by both Earthkind and Spacekind to all areas of space and celestial bodies consistent with the best interests of the mental and physical welfare of Spacekind and its existing habitats, regardless of their political or Earth sovereign origins. Article 2. Space habitats, including orbiting platforms and those existing on or beneath the surface of celestial bodies, shall not be subject to claims of national sovereignty or citizenship deriving from or exercised by nation states or regional jurisdictions located or originating on Earth. Spacekind occupying such habitats shall exercise independent cultural and political sovereignty, and in no matter shall space habitat sovereignty or inhabitant citizenship be related to any territory or geographical boundaries on Earth. Subject to certain provisions set forth below relating to jurisdictional transitions between space habitats and Earth, the conduct and activities of Earth space travel shall be subject to the Outer Space Treaty of 1967, the Agreement on the Rescue of Astronauts, the Return of Astronauts, and the Return of Objects Launched into Outer Space, the Convention on Registration of Objects Launched into Outer Space, and all other applicable international and space law. Article 3. States parties to this treaty shall conduct their relations among each other and severally and collectively with Spacekind in a matter consistent with international law. The Charter of the United Nations or any successor organization and consistent with developing law among Spacekind in the interest of maintaining peace and security and promoting cooperation and understanding not only among Earth cultures, but also between Earth cultures and cultures unique to space. Article 4. The use of military personnel for scientific research, for any other non-hostile and peaceful purposes requiring interaction with space habitats, communities, and inhabitants shall not be prohibited, provided, however, that there shall be no bilateral or regional military relationships or alliances whatsoever established between any one or more states parties to this treaty and any space habitat and its inhabitants. A military alliance may be established between space habitat communities and the United Nations or its successor organization only for the protection of Earth or space habitats and their inhabitants against threats or hostile action originating from cultures, civilizations, or political entities not deriving ultimately from Earthkind or Earth indigenous public or private organizations or consortia. Article 5. States parties to this treaty shall regard Spacekind as envoys of a culture or civilization different from those of Earthkind. In the event of accident, distress, emergency landing on the territory of any state party hereto, or on the high seas of Earth, or in the event of any unforeseen or fortuitous situations experienced by representatives of Spacekind on Earth or in space, all reasonable steps shall be undertaken by parties to this treaty to assist such representatives and return them to appropriate authorities and jurisdictions on Earth or in space as hereinafter described. States parties to this treaty shall inform immediately the other states parties to this treaty of any phenomena they discover in, near, or deep space or on the surface of Earth which could constitute a danger to the life or welfare of representatives of Spacekind. Article 6. Each state party to this treaty shall bear international and interspace responsibility
for its own national activities in space that may adversely affect any space habitat or its inhabitants. All commercial activities shall be conducted in strict accord with the principles set forth herein, regardless of whether such activities are carried out by governmental agencies or non-governmental agencies. Each party to this treaty shall assure severally that such national or regional activities in near and deep space in which it is involved are conducted in conformity with existing international and prevailing interspace law, including the provisions set forth herein. When activities which substantially affect the socio-political independence and general welfare of space habitat communities and space kind are conducted in space by an Earth indigenous international organization, responsibility for compliance with this treaty shall be borne both by such international organization and by the state parties to this treaty that are participating in such organization. Article 7. In the conduct of all space-related activities directly involving space habitats and space kind representatives, states parties to this treaty shall be guided by the principles of cooperation and mutual assistance and shall temper their relationships with due regard for the cultural independence of space kind. States parties to this treaty shall pursue studies of near and deep space in such a manner as to avoid harmful interference and adverse changes in the ecosystems and cultural integrity of space-kind habitats which might be caused by the introduction of harmful alien material or the imposition of insensitive and harmful alien cultural characteristics that are not consistent with individual freedom and the cultural independence of the habitat society. If a state party to this treaty has any reason to believe that an activity or experiment planned by it or its nationals in near or deep space might cause potentially harmful interference with space habitats or space-kind cultures, it shall undertake effective international consultations among other states' parties hereto, as well as with the space-kind cultures which may be affected by such activity or experiment. Any state a party hereto may demand reasonable consultation with any other state party to this treaty and any space-kind community regarding an activity or experiment suspected of being potentially harmful to Earth, the space community, or to Earth-kind or space-kind generally. Article 8. In order to ensure the integrity of the peaceful purposes and intents embodied in this treaty, all states parties hereto that establish space habitats of a long duration or permanent nature shall establish them in such a manner that they shall be open for cultural examinations and military investigation by representatives of other states parties to this treaty on the basis of reciprocity. Such examination and investigation shall not occur as a matter of right hereunder beyond the second generation of space kind born to any subject space habitat community. States parties to this treaty shall give the subject space habitat community and its founding state party hereto reasonable advance notice of any examination or investigation or attendant visit to the space habitat community, in order that appropriate consultations may be held and that maximum precaution may be taken to assure safety and to avoid unnecessary interference with normal operations of the community or culture to be examined, investigated, or visited. Article 9. States parties to this treaty agree that there shall be established an expert organization under the aegis of the United Nations or its successor entity to be called the International Organization for Sentient Space Activities, IOSSA. The principal purposes of this organization, to be established under separate charter, are threefold. 1. Provide an interdisciplinary international academy to review constantly all aspects of interactive relationships between Earthkind and spacekind that occur either in outer space or on the surface of Earth. 2. Grant international agreements of recognition and capacity to those space communities that meet the requisites for home rule established in the Charter of IOSSA, and 3. Refer case situations to the International Court of Justice and any correspondent or successor court of transnational law wherein the propriety and predictable compatibility of such interactive relationships are at issue among expert representatives of states parties to this treaty, as well as those representing outer space cultures and space community inhabitants. The Academy shall serve as the sole expert advisory body to the court in such matters. The International Academy shall establish jurisdictional frameworks and legal regimes to encompass activities involving interactions among permanent or long-duration inhabitants of outer space and Earth indigenes, regardless of the physical location of the interactions. We have about 10 minutes left. We'll open the phones. 602-337-2524. 602-337-2524 is the number. And if you've been sitting spellbound for the last two nights and just cannot believe what you've been hearing, or if you have information that we don't have, we would like to hear from you. 602-337-2524 is the number. And folks, the phones are open. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hello, Bill. I love your show, and I'm glad you're out there doing this for us.
Thank you.
I am a NCO in a special operations group, one of the black shirt guys.
Yeah.
And I'm telling you what, if there was ever a time that America needed its militias, it's now. You guys do what you have to, and us old-time NCOs are trying to talk to our youngsters and let them know what's necessary to be done here, whether you're going to be an American or whether you're going to be part of some kind of New World Order garbage.
Well, thank you.
Hey, keep up the good work.
And God bless you.
Thank you very much, and you too. Bye.
Well, we get interesting calls on this broadcast, ladies and gentlemen. You all heard that one. Good evening. You're on the air.
This is Jeffrey in New Orleans.
Hello, Jeffrey. How are you?
Well, I'm pretty good. I got the books in. My parents got them in Thibodeau, and they should be sending in the recordings for the blind in January so they can get recorded.
Wonderful.
But I have some further information for you concerning our activities with the Soviet Union. I'll bet a lot of people didn't know that Major George Lacy Jordan, head of the Lend-Lease in World War II, spotted the fact that we gave our gold mining machinery, our copper wires, and our nuclear atomic secrets to the Soviets in 1943 in Great Falls, Montana, which is one of the reasons why your gold prices are the way they are, because of the Soviet mining, etc. That's still going on, and don't kid yourself, the Commonwealth of Independent States is still same old bunch, look at Chechnya, etc.
Yes.
And of course, the point is that that when we hear all about the Julius and Ethel Rosenberg business, that was a cover-up to hide the fact that our government has been cooperating with the communists for years. And one other thing. In 1974, on around 700 kilocycles on shortwave, just above the 49-meter band, I heard some strange broadcasts about space people working on the surface of planets, which were broadcast over shortwave, but which were never identified. I was told at the time that these may possibly have been military astronauts working in outer space. So I'm not surprised at the material I'm hearing tonight.
Well, good for you, Jeffrey, and thank you for the information.
And Happy New Year.
Happy New Year to you, too, and everybody else.
Thank you.
And thank you for calling. Yeah, folks, William Casey. You know, I don't believe for one moment that he died of natural causes right before he was supposed to testify to Congress. You see, William Casey is a man who was truthful, if not secretive. If he was asked by Congress the right questions, he would have told them the truth. So I believe that he committed suicide, probably using his cyanide tablet, and he may have been a little bit tougher than what they thought, and it might have caused him a lot of pain in the hours that it took him to die. But William Casey was also responsible for giving the Soviet Union the technology, the equipment, and the brains from the United States to build the Kama River truck factory, the largest rolling stock factory in the world, ladies and gentlemen, could produce more trucks and tanks and armored military equipment from that factory in the Soviet Union than all of the combined manufacturing capability of the entire United States of America. William Casey was the head of the Central Intelligence Agency. Good evening. You're on the air.
Good evening, Bill. It's Monty from Vermont calling.
Hello, Monty.
How you doing?
Good.
Just wanted to talk, if you could, on about page 421 in your book, the letter from Gordon Cooper to Ambassador Griffith, the mission of Grenada to the United Nations. Very interesting letter you have in your book.
Yes,
and the seal down in the bottom left-hand corner, which looks like a UFO. And the top line being WED Enterprises, a division of Buena Vista Distribution, a subsidiary of Walt Disney, Mr. 33rd Degree himself.
That's correct. You see all kinds of things like that. But in that letter, astronaut Gordon Cooper said that he saw on many occasions UFOs in space. He said that they were extraterrestrial and that we should set up some kind of diplomatic liaison with these visitors from other planets.
It's rather interesting. Just goes to prove another Masonic link.
Oh, yes. There's a lot of them. Thank you very much.
If you get a chance, Bill, would you discuss that in some future?
Well, maybe. I don't have time to do it tonight. But
I realize that.
Everybody sort of, I think they got the gist of what it says. Thank you.
Thanks, Bill.
Good night.
Bye.
602-337-2524 is the number. Folks, when you start digging into this stuff, you'll be absolutely amazed what you come up with. Now, remember, I've never said that extraterrestrials don't exist. I've never said that I don't believe that they exist. What I've said is I don't believe for one minute that all that we're being presented with is of extraterrestrial origin. I believe that it's being presented to create us, to create in our minds, I should say, or in our collective consciousness, to use a New Age term, which is appropriate, apropos, that we are being threatened by some extraterrestrial species from space. I'm going to tell you this. And this is true from all the investigations that I've ever done. If extraterrestrials are real, and if they're visiting this Earth, there are no danger to us whatsoever. And when the United States government says UFOs do not represent a threat to the national security, they are telling you the truth. Good evening. You're on the air.
Well, I've been listening to you for a long time, and you definitely shocked me last night when you gave out the information on the treaty. That treaty definitely leads one to believe that that's already been negotiated, signed, and sealed.
Well, remember, when I was in the Office of Naval Intelligence, I saw top-secret documents that said that that was absolutely true.
And I'm going to take a trip down to the Smithsonian tomorrow, the Air and Space Museum, and see if I can find a copy of that book.
If anybody has it, it should be the Smithsonian Institution since they published it.
But thanks a lot for giving that information. I can't wait to get it. Thanks.
You're welcome. 602-337-2524. Got time for maybe one or two more calls if you want to get them in here real quick. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hey, Bill. This is Greg from Seattle.
Hi, Greg.
And I'm calling to check on the status of your new book, when it might be out.
It's in the process of editing right now.
Mm-hmm. And how long?
Shouldn't be too much longer.
Great. Does it have a lot about the secret societies in it?
I'm not going to tell anybody anything about what's in it, and I'm not going to give anybody any definite date that it's going to be out, simply because if something goes wrong or whatever, that or we have to do like we did with the first one and take a lot of stuff out, nobody will be disappointed.
Oh, okay. Well, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Bye-bye.
602-337-2524. We still may have time for two more calls if we can get them in here. Any kind of a reasonable amount of time. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hi, Bill.
Hello.
I've got a question for you. I just gave your book to a friend of mine for Christmas, and I know that your views on...
Turn off your radio.
Sorry, it's across the room. I'll cover up my mouthpiece.
Yep. Sorry, my friend. Can't do that. I've told you a million times. You call a radio station, turn off your radio. It causes all kinds of problems with the equipment in my ears. With trying to get a level on the caller, all of that stuff. 602-337-2524 is the number. If you want to be the last caller for the night, you should call in right now. 602-337-2524. Good evening, you're on the air.
Hi, Bill. How you doing?
Good.
All right. My name is Michael. I'm calling from Fort Polk, Louisiana. I'm in the Army, and I just read your book. It's incredible, and I want you to know that your life must be in danger. How do you live with it?
Well, why should anybody care? They didn't care whether my life was in danger when they sent me to Vietnam. They didn't care if the guys' lives were in danger when they sent them to the Middle East to fight that phony desert scam, did they?
No, they didn't at all.
Then why are you asking me?
Bill, I want you to know that there are people out there that care. You're telling everybody what's going on, and hey, we're out here.
Well, good. I'm not pinging on you. I'm trying to make a point here.
Right.
You know, I'm here in this country, really, for the first time in my life, really fighting for my country. And all of a sudden, everybody thinks there's something wrong with that. I should be afraid or it's really dangerous or something. But they didn't give a damn when they sent me to Vietnam. Nobody said a word. Nobody came down to the airport and said, hey, aren't you scared? Nothing. It blows my mind.
That's the way it is, I guess.
What's going on at Fort Polk?
Not a damn thing. There's nobody here. And maybe a few patriots here and there, but hey, I'm associated with Atlanta, so I'm all right.
Good. Okay.
Well, Happy New Year.
Happy New Year to you, too.
Take it easy.
And, folks, that was the last call for the evening. Good night, and God bless every single one of you. The boys are coming from California soon. Bart, Jerry, all of you people, get out here. We got work for you to do. We're going to start the newspaper in January, ladies and gentlemen. And in the next few broadcasts, we'll let you know what the subscription rate is. If you're a member, you get it automatically. We're coming together, folks. We're going to do great things. These young people are sorely needed, and they're going to give us a lot of help. And we're waiting breathlessly for them to arrive.